Welcome back to Obscure Gaming, the segment in which I'm all for animal violence in video games. Take that, PETA, you bastards! After I'm done with this video, I'm gonna go get some McNuggets just to spite you fuckers, wearing an I Hate PETA t-shirt. It's gonna be great. But speaking of animal violence, though, what's more obscure than a fighting game based on people who change into animal people? Wait, I'll just answer that for you. Nothing! So in the spirit of fighting games, and animal violence, fuck you, PETA, today on Obscure Gaming, I'll be talking about Bloody Roar 3. Now some may say, Yuriofwind, what's a Bloody Roar 3, and is Santa Claus real? Good questions. I'm not going to answer that second one, but Bloody Roar was a series of 3D fighting games that had an interesting twist involving animals. That twist isn't nearly as horrible as it may sound if you have no prior knowledge of the series. Don't worry, it's not a fanfic. Or at least the games aren't a fanfic. If I know the internet as well as I think I do, and I think I know it pretty fucking well, there's probably tons of fanfics out there that may scar you. So we're going to avoid that mental scarring for the time being and just talk about the game's rich story. Now there's a running theme of me talking about fighting games and saying, well guys, story isn't important because it's all about the game, blah, 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 blah. And Bloody Roar 3 doesn't change this one bit. But hey, it doesn't have to. That's not why I bought this game so many years ago. But even so, I should probably give you a dramatic reading of the plot that the game provides us with. Ahem. Had to clear my voice. The Sign of the Beast. A symbol, shining with an eerie light. It appears without warning. To those it marks, it brings ultimate power and mysterious death. The sign appears only on the Beast Men, or women. We don't need to be fucking sexist here. The last thing we need are alternate universe feminists coming to kill us. But, Beast people. Humans with the power to assume bestial form. And through them, it sends ripples of terror and unrest throughout the civilized world. My god, this game takes place in a universe where the world is civilized. That just sounds sick and disgusting. When those powerful beast men or women who fought for both their future and that of mankind found this mark on their bodies, they set out on a quest, each with their own dreams and their own burning ambitions. They sought the one whose will lurked. Lurks, sorry, I misread that, but it's stupid, so I don't care, and I'm not gonna edit this out. Behind the sign and its source of power. Woo fucking who? From there, it's your standard, hey, pick this guy and go through the story thing, and then you get an ending, okay, bye. And it's really nothing special at that point, so we're going to ignore it and just move on to the gameplay. Now, as I stated, Bloody Roar 3 is a 3D fighting game. It features modes you'd expect out of any fighter. Stuff like arcade, survival, blah. You have 14 characters to choose from, two of which have to be unlocked. And then, of course, you have the 3D fighting. Which, while it's more simplistic than other fighters, it's still fun and has an interesting twist. You have a punch button, a kick button, and a throw button. All of those are pretty self-explanatory. Now, when I said that the game was simplistic, it's because a lot of the combos and the damage you'll deal out will be executed by double-tapping a direction or holding a direction and just hitting a button, or just pressing a button multiple times and BOOM! You have a combo. Now, there are more complex combos you can make use of, and even some special moves here or there, but really, none of that is necessary unless your local tournament scene has gone nuts and started holding tourneys or Bloody Roar 3. In that case, learn some combos, but for everyone else, just learn the fundamentals and you'll be fine. And so this is where I would call this just an average 3D fighter, but this is where that interesting twist I mentioned earlier comes into play, as each character has the ability to enter a beast mode, and entering this mode adds a nice new dynamic to the combat. Once you enter your beast state, you're opened up to more attack options, the ability to recover some health, and most importantly, the ability to do super moves. And that's a neat twist for a fighter to have. The ability to transform is a cool one. Though, when I think of transforming, I think of Super Sentai or Kamen Rider, not animals, because, well, look, I don't know about you guys, but I kind of get a furry vibe off of this series. I think it might be that animal thing. And hey, if you're a furry, cool for you, I guess, but for everyone else, just don't think about it, because if you think about it, then it's just going to make everything really awkward. Next thing you know, you've stumbled upon a horrible fanfic that will more likely than not ruin your entire life, so don't walk down that extremely dark path. But, anyways, all in all, the game is fun to play. It's not super complex, but not every fighter has to be. It just has to be fun, and not only is this game fun, but the series as a whole is very fun, if nothing else. And really, what more could you ask for? And I know what you're thinking. Lots of money. Because you can buy happiness with that. Some people say you can't, but some people are fucking stupid. So while we mull over that life lesson, let's talk about the game's presentation. Now, Bloody Roar 3 was an early PS2 game, so it's not the best-looking title on the platform, but for what it is, it looks good. Character models look fine and animate well enough, the environments look a tad bland, always, but they're destructible environments, so while they're not exciting to look at, you get to blast people through walls, and that never ceases to be entertaining. The audio is okay. I really like the music. Some tracks were kind of ass, but most of them set the tone for battle very nicely. And the opening theme is just fucking ridiculously catchy. That's the song you heard at the beginning of the video, in case anyone asks that. It's really good. As for voice acting, the only voice acting you get is whatever the characters say during a match, and whatever they say at the end of the match, and that's all. Yeah. Now, I could give a shit what everyone is saying during a match, because based on my experience, it's mostly hua and and your occasional scream of pain. When it comes to what they're saying after the match, most of the time you can't even really hear them that well. You'll win with Hugo, for example, and he'll be all like, full moon! And yeah, I know I could just go adjust the settings, but I think it's really funny that by default it's like that. Maybe it helps hide the fact that the voice acting is terrible. But all in all, the presentation is good in the spots that count, and for an early PS2 game, that's pretty fucking good. There's some other early PS2 games that look and sound like shit. I know, I own some of them, and don't think I'm not going to talk about them eventually. I'm making a hit list, and checking it twice, I'm like Santa Claus. But that's Bloody Roar 3, an enjoyable, horrific fighting game for the PS2. If you like fighting games and know nothing about this series, I'd give it a look, but if you can't find this title, try the 4th, or the PS1 games, or the versions that were released for the GameCube or original Xbox. Unfortunately, I can't point you in the direction of a newer title as the series' future is unknown at this point, but hopefully they'll make a new one someday. After Capcom inevitably floods the market with too many fighting games, causes them to crash yet again, so we don't see one for like 10 years. And if, when that happens, I called it. Then everyone can say, hey, he called it. In any case, this has been Obscure Gaming. Thanks for watching.